Já os autoconvocados são aquelas almas que se propuseram a estarem encarnadas hoje, nesta época, e que se ofereceram a trabalhar para o plano evolutivo nesses momentos críticos do planeta.
Plan, in these most critical moments of the planet that is just starting. So the self-convoked ones. Planetary crisis and influence in that. So a self-convoked one that offered himself to that has his own destiny and has his own task. The task of the self-convoked ones are not the same. So there are some self-convoked people to respond to many types of needs. So we have to analyze our inner being and check if we are really a self-convoked one. If we are a self-convoked person, a soul that has chosen to be here in this time, we are ready for everything. We accept any task, we do not choose any task, and if it is possible, we give our lives for the task. This is a true self-convoked person. So a person asks if the self-convoked person exists out of the monasteries. Of course, there are self-convoked ones inside and outside the monasteries. The self-convoked people, if necessary, give their lives to that. It is a very special call. Another person asks, why the animals suffer? Why does the animal suffer and have karma if they do not have free will? So each animal doesn't have a free will, but the animal kingdom as a whole has a soul, and this animal soul is the responsible in some extent to all that has happened to the animal kingdom so far. So the whole story of the animal kingdom is registered in the soul of the kingdom. So each member of this kingdom has the part of the whole karma of the whole race. So they do not have free will, but they have a destiny, and the soul designates one way of living, and but they have the karma of the whole animal kingdom, and we do not know what story they lived since the beginning of the earth. We know that the animal, before the flood, they were very destructive. And since it is the same kingdom that come from this history, this prehistorical karma, it is being divided until today. The law of karma is very merciful. It doesn't apply the whole law of karma at once. So before the great flood, if the animals had a very heavy karma compared to the animals of today, this karma was divided between every animal. So to each animal, one animal deserves one part of the karma and divide the karma with the others. So one person says that in the Gospels they mention many animals like crows, like snakes, and they are shown as bad creatures. And if this comparison is not biased and make people understand differently, and have a different relation with the animals. So these texts we need to try to see in the Bible what was written at that time and what is valid to today. Because when Mary, our instructor, told us to read the Bible, she has mentioned the Gospels of the New Testament. She didn't mention the Old Testament, for instance, that was written for that specific time, even though it has laws that are useful so far and laws that were not comprehended until today. But the parables of the New Testament, we have many suggestions and instructions, and to that we were invited to read very specially in these times. And one person said that internally she has consecrated herself to the work of Mary, to the Universal Mother, but she said that she never had the opportunity of coming to a ceremony of consecration. Well, and she doesn't know how may she be consecrated in such a ceremony, because it is not programmed any visit, pilgrimage of the group in the country that she lives. Well, a consecration, it is in reality an inner movement. You consecrate yourself to Mary internally, and if this consecration happens, it's no need of an external ceremony. So if you were always consecrated to Mary, who knows if you are consecrated already and you didn't realize it yet. So it is important that as a consecrated person to Mary, that you consider yourself, you may offer yourself to serve the plan and to be at the service of Mary, and then you may start, begin feeling in some task. Another person said that her husband has disincarnated in 2016 by a pancreas cancer, and she asks if this disease is a rescue. Yes, the cancer is a disease that purifies all of our evilness. We use evilness since our first incarnation, and now and then the life that is incarnating has a cancer, and in this cancer it is rescued, or in this cancer it is canceled, this evilness, through the fire that the cancer produces. And this disease comes and cancels much of our evilness. So even though cancer is not a very accepted disease, cancer is a very definite way of purification for our evilness in our unconsciousness, in our subconsciousness also. And she asks if her husband then may be in a good place. Well, if he has suffered with this disease before dying, much purification he has gotten, but do not wait for meeting him in another plane. You just deliver this, surrender this to your soul and his soul, because it is our souls and our spirits that organize correctly our meetings. So you trust that your soul or your spirit will promote the meeting of your soul or your spirit with his soul and with his spirit wherever he is. Trust that, because your soul and his soul know if you need to be meeting again or not, or will be meeting again in another incarnation. The most important part of this all is you to pray and ask for light over this subject so that you may understand these subjects spiritually, and not understanding these subjects in a human way or mentally. Because one thing is our mental comprehension of life and our human comprehension of life, and another thing is our spiritual comprehension of life. It's a totally different comprehension. Since when you are in a human comprehension, you are in the level of humanity that accepts or does not accept what the destiny brings to her, to him or her. But if you reach a spiritual comprehension, you do not have any of these problems, and do not think anymore in these subjects, and pray so that you may have a spiritual comprehension of life. Then you will never have any more this kind of problem, and you will accept what life would bring to you in a good way, in a good mood, with donation. And this is the key for you to develop something very well. Because even though you don't have a certain training, a certain possibility of developing something, some subject in your life, some task, you may try to surrender, to deliver that to your superior levels. Then some help may, and qualities may emerge, some possibilities may emerge that you do not even think about it. And another person is asking, what is the rescue of humanity? Look how important is this question. In what the rescue of humanity consists? It consists in being the humanity being forgiven of all its ancient karma, and at the same time it must forgive its own self. So if you ask forgiveness to the high, to the plan, to God, you may be prepared to, in receiving this forgiveness, to forgive your own self and surrender to the service of the plan and serve the plan. Of course that the divine mercy forgives humanity as it forgave humanity when Christ came in the first time, and will forgive again in his return, so that the humanity may go on. Even though these subjects are very mysterious and we do not know well the history of these things, it's good that we have this very clear and we accept things how they are. Accept that you will be forgiven, and at the same time forgive your own self. Do not forget of forgiving you your own self, because we have the trend in a certain moment of our evolutionary line, we have the trend of not forgiving ourselves, to blame ourselves. Look, if at this moment we are having the trend of the forgiveness of the whole humanity, you rush and start forgiving your own self. Forgive your own self, because forgiveness comes from the high. And the problem is, the point is to forgive your own self of that you consider your own faults. And you are able to forgive your own selves if you put yourselves to service, to serve humanity, to serve the divine plan. This matches very much with your movement of forgiving your own self. And if you put yourself to service, to serve, you will be able to forgive yourself. One person has been in the hospital and passed in much, so many experiences. And during this process, she had many visions and she got impressed by some. Look, visions, when they are not coming at the same time with the comprehension of what you are seeing, you take care of that, those visions, because the true vision, the spiritual vision, the correct vision, authentic, when it comes, it doesn't come with any doubt. You have the vision and you know what it means. If you are having a vision and that is something that you do not comprehend, this is a very mental thing. It's a movement of your mind, of your emotional body. And these visions that brings on disharmony, and you make that the sign of the cross, and then this vision disappears. And if you cannot make the sign of the cross with the gesture that this is the ideal movement, you may do it mentally, and then the vision dissolves. When it's a legitimate vision, an evolutionary and real vision, sent from the height, sent from your soul or your spirit, you have no doubt. You are before the vision and you know what it is happening there. And if you have any doubt, your own inner world will reveal to you what is happening. We know that there are many visionaries that see something and they cannot understand what they see, because this may happen because at that time, at that moment, some problem in the contact happened. But the true vision doesn't bring any doubt. It brings in itself its own meaning. And there are many levels of visionaries, such as there are many levels of people like us that may have visions, but all people are in evolution. Visions also evolve. The process of vision evolves. Everything evolves. But for that, it is needed that when you are in a determined process, you do not get attached to it. If you are in a path of developing a vision, do not get attached to it. Do not get attached to any vision. Keep yourself free, and then this process will be evolved, and have the concern of not desiring any vision, but to receive a vision with total openness and joy when it comes spontaneously. And if it comes spontaneously, it may bring to you some teaching, some meaning for you. Many people think that we are talking about one thing that is not normal, because many people think that it's not normal to have visions. Yes, it has never been normal to have visions, but we are ingressing a moment of so much need that the vision may be open to someone when he or she is not waiting for that. And it may come as a grace, and if the person received a grace without considering being a visionary, never being a visionary, if he or she receives that, he or she may have this faith of that they will understand what it is happening. We have to have faith in our evolutionary path, our evolutionary process, and we would never need to have some plans for our evolutionary process, because we have to have a faith that we are in evolutionary law and we are being guided by a inner force, by our superior levels. And one person is very uneasy because one of her cats have died of a problem in the kidney. And then she had two other cats that disincarnated of this failure of the kidneys, and she got very worried because she knew, she learned that the animals transmutate many things that happen to us. So she's feeling some kind of blame for the cats that she loved so much, for them having died from this failure in the kidneys. And she's wondering if they were transmutating things from her. Well, we do not know what happened with these cats, but what we may talk about is the general process of transmutation in the animal kingdom. We know that we have many things to transmutate in us and in our environment. And when we have animals with us, we know that these animals help us in this transmutation. But you do not have to worry about it, because this is one task of the animals, one service of the animals to us. And if we make with love our task with the animal kingdom, automatically and by karma, the animals start transmutating our things. This is their work, as it were our task to love them and treat them so that they would evolve. So if you are loving the animals that you have, if you are treating them the best way possible that you know, if they are transmutating something from you, it's a collaboration work. You do not get worried about it. This is a collaboration work, and what you need to have is a faith that your transmutation will be in the degree that that you can receive, and the capacity of them, the animals, to receive and transmutate. So you live in a collaboration life. So when we have more love to the animal kingdoms and the nature kingdoms of nature, we will know many things that the mineral kingdom, the plant kingdom, and the animal kingdom may provide to us. But we need to have this disposition not only to love them, these kingdoms, but to serve them, and not only to explore them. And one person is asking regarding the donation of the organs. She is uncertain of donating the organs, leaving this allowance to the organs to be forwarded to someone. Well, always that we transfer one organ to other person, the one that receives the part of a karma of our body, because we have our individual karma, our body has its physical karma of that incarnation in it, and each organ of this body has its own karma connected to our karma of our previous lives. So when we donate one organ, we should do it just if we have an inner order to do it. Then we donate our organ, because then fate will take this organ to someone that will be able to assume its karma, the karma of the organ inside his own body. So the person that receives the organ must have an inner order to receive the organ of someone else, because this means that he or she may be able to assume this organ, and your his or her process will have the ability of absorb this organ. Unfortunately, material science does not deals with that, because it deals in a very material level with things. When the scientists have a very conscious inner life, when a scientist has a very searched inner life, a regular inner life, science will change a lot, but maybe it's not for our days. But for the new world, it will be. For the new humanity, this will be. So there is the karma of the person, the karma of the body, of the physical body of the person. That is another kind of karma inserted in her or his own karma. And there is the karma of the own organ of the body. If I used my voice badly, probably in some moment I will get voiceless. And this is the karma of my vocal cords. And I have to accept that, so that this may be resolved, may be solved, and this accomplish its own part, so that later on the organ that is going through this karma will finish its process. So there is our karma, it is the karma of the body, and there is the karma of the organs, and someday the scientists will know how to deal with that, and will be able to treat us much better. And one person asks us to explain if Judas was really a traitor, or if he was serving for something that we do not know, because she knew that there was a prophecy that Christ would be betrayed, and Christ himself knew that he was going to be betrayed. So Judas was a traitor, or he was playing a role. Both things, because he wouldn't be able to be put in a role of a traitor to accomplish the karma of a betrayal, if he was not a traitor, and he accomplished a task. And between the traitors, maybe he was chosen to accomplish, to play this role, and God knows why, and destiny knows why. So Judas has betrayed. That was written in the prophecies. But Jesus said that she said that it was better if he has never betrayed Jesus. This was one phrase, one sentence credited to Jesus. Jesus came to be betrayed also. It was prophesied, and someone had to play that role of the betrayal. It is very mysterious what Christ said, that it would be better if he, Judas, never betrayed him. But before these mysteries, we need to silence ourselves and not try to work on it in our minds. We would need to silence ourselves and take from each fact of that, of those, each event of those found in the Bible, to take that what regards us and what that may teach us something. So we need to take, to extract from the episodes what really, that really serves us. And in some moment, if one of those episodes does not talk to us something important, it will serve another people. So we never discuss when we are before effect, especially those of the Bible, when we not comprehend, we do not comprehend that. It suffices to say that Christ has been betrayed and Judas has betrayed him, and it would be very much better for Judas if he did not betray Jesus. All the rest we do not know, and we will know when we are more evolved people. And one person is part of the network of light in Portugal. And she is asking for some clarification regarding one of the manifestations and one of the instructions that the divine hierarchy has been given to us. And she has very serious doubts regarding the content of these transmissions, but she's a member of one network of light, but she has these doubts. Well, see, when you are before some manifestation brought by a divine being, what you comprehend of that, you thank that and you apply that in your life. But what you do not comprehend, do not worry about it. Have patience, because one day you will comprehend that. If you received that teaching, what you comprehended of that, you live immediately. And what you did not comprehend, you wait, because it seems that you are not comprehending, but the teaching has introduced it in you, and it is preparing you to comprehend, to being comprehended by you someday. So this is the way we are before the divine hierarchy. Not always what they say to us, you accept or understand, but you accept with all of your heart, and this will ingress you, enter you, and it will be useful someday. And that has permeated our unconscious part, and it is preparing us for something. We need to be before this happening, this apparitions that is happening, with much openness and much available, never questioning, because something that we do not comprehend, if we love and thank, this will work on us so much that someday you will understand that and much more. And one person asks, what is the key for us to achieve neutrality? Look how important it is, because we know that especially in the tribulation times, in the tribulated, in the very complicated and difficult moments that we may go through, neutrality is very important. And the person needs to know how can she or he be neutral. First of all, you need to want to be neutral. If you do not want to be neutral, you will never be. So here you must use your ray of will. So if you know that during the transition or in the difficulty moments that may emerge, you must be neutral, you must, first of all, you need to want to develop neutrality. This is fundamental. So after that, if you do want to develop neutrality, every trial that come, each test that come to involve you, you realize that you are before a trial, a test, and during that involvement, you undo that involvement, you work on that involvement, and become neutral, because the process begins when you are not able to be neutral, but you remember that, and then use your will, make your effort, and you will be able to become neutral. If you persist in this exercise, if you persist in this work, if you keep yourself in this faith, neutrality will come, neutrality will happen. And do not worry do not try to come, do not try to have it very fast. You continue looking for neutrality, try to be neutral before every test that may come to you. And someday you will have a great surprise, because before one thing that would alter you very much, you will be neutral, and you didn't make any effort. The thing happened for itself, because you made so much effort before that you have granted this grace. And then you will admire yourself, because you realize that it was the first time that you got neutral. This is how things happen in reality. So for finishing, one person is asking, why do we do not make some lectures in great auditoriums as we did before in São Paulo, for instance? Well, the times here now are different. When we went there in São Paulo, making some sharing, some lectures in very crowded places, this were another moment. People of São Paulo would be able to go out on the streets without any risk. And we were able to invite hundreds of people to go to an auditorium to listen to a lecture. But time has changed, and we have to follow the changes. Now we have the technology and the communication, means of communication, that you may produce a lecture and reach much more, many more people, such as in this transmission, than the ones that may fit in an auditorium. So we do not put people at risk, inviting them to go out, and you reach where the people are using correctly for the good, with good intentions and evolution, and one mean of communication. So since we realize that these means of communication that we are using now are available, there is no need of going to an auditorium to make a lecture and putting people at risk. It doesn't mean that people do not have to go out from their homes. One thing is to go out when you have to go out, and another thing is to go out when you didn't need to go out. So when you go out because you need to go out, you have some kind of protection when you go out. But when you go out without needing going out, you may not have the same kind of protection. Well, with all the means that we have today, and with all the warnings that we may give in such a lecture, there is no need of going out from here and make some lecture in an auditorium. The only reason is that just in São Paulo, just in the place the lecture would happen, this would be a very good reason. But there is no sign for us to go to São Paulo to make certain lectures, because just there the lecture would happen. Why? By many reasons that we do not know. There are many times that when we meet the need, things open so that the energy may flow better. But when we save, we protect ourselves, maybe the energy is not so much opened. So what I said about not having some lectures, making some lectures in auditoriums, is what I'm telling now, because it's not for tomorrow, because we do not know what will be the circumstances for tomorrow. So with the coming of the transition of the Earth, and with the openness that we will have to surprising facts, We have to dispose ourselves to serve without any condition, without saying, I will serve the plane doing this or that, talking from home or not serving in an auditorium of São Paulo. We should eliminate everything. And we need to serve the plan and you check what the plan is asking you and what the plan says, you have to follow it. Because if you accomplish, if you follow the plan, you will have all the help that the plan may give you. But if you want the plan to give one task in your own way, the way you want, and when you want, and where you want to accomplish, then you are really out of the path. So we do not have so far any orientation of having, making some lecture in an auditorium in São Paulo, but this doesn't mean that this will never happen anymore. We have to learn not to create some expectancies about things and how we would serve or work. This serves to everyone, not just for this case that was mentioned here. Well, before finishing, we would like to invite you to a work of music for the healing and the elevation of humanity that will happen here in Figueira on the next Saturday, 23rd of April. It will be a very interesting work that we will listen to some canticles, and those that we are not able to receive the energy in this own place, you will be able to find this through the internet Saturday, 8 p.m. through the Mercy Mary TV. We offer the music for the healing and elevation of humanity. It is a program that we will have monthly. And we also want to communicate to you that in this monthly hour, maybe in the next month, when you will receive the information of the time and day, we will begin another cycle of work that will be Planet Earth, a being in redemption. We will talk about this being that is the planet Earth, that is a being in redemption, and this being in redemption needs that we take care of the kingdoms of nature in a certain way. So we will develop some work regarding this issue, this subject, in the sense of trying to approach the kingdoms of nature in a different way. You are all invited to that. So we will see through this means in the next month of May, and let's see the planet Earth, a being in redemption. If you have some questions to make regarding this subject, please send, because then we will enrich the work and it will be more according to what you need to listen. We are receiving from now on the questions regarding this being that is our planet, that it is in redemption. What would that be, right? And how could we collaborate to that? And how can we work in this so important moment of the planet and of the planet? Thank you very much, and see you soon.